A very good evening and warm welcome in this rainy monsoon time in Bangalore. Welcome to this edition of public talks organized by Azim Premji University. My name is Seema Purushottaman. I am a faculty of sustainability at Azim Premji University. Before introducing the speaker, which I'm sure most of you may not, but still I'll give a try, I will just have two words about why this talk or this topic. Despite the rapid urbanization around, India still is mostly rural. And in the rural, the small-scale farmers are still very significant in number, as well as their role in giving us with food, water, and even our health, welfare. As city dwellers, we depend a lot on them. And despite being so important, and despite being omnipresent, actually, you don't need to travel to rural India to see one small farmer. Perhaps you would have just met one before you got into the auditorium, the security guard at the gate, the driver who dropped you here, or the maid who cleaned your house today. Any of them could be a small farmer in Indian rural. But despite their presence everywhere and the sheer large numbers, their voice is so feeble, and we don't really spend time thinking about what we do to them as city dwellers and the signals we give in terms of demand from them, what we actually expect from their fields. Who better than Professor Amit Bhaduri can remind us about what we as city dwellers actually bring out as impacts on these small farmers in the rural? Professor Bhaduri has spent a lot of years working on smallholders, and he did that by expanding the conventional focal area of an otherwise slightly indifferent lens of economic theory. And only such an unconventional economist can actually coin concepts like forced commercialization of peasant households and right, these concepts reflected in his works, starting with economics, the economic structure of peasant households, which was published in early 80s. And of late, closer to 2010, he has another book, which again is an offbeat economic view on the face that you will never want to see. And who else could better deserve the prestigious Leontief Prize, which is instituted for contributions to economic theory as it is applied to the contemporary realities and contributing to a just and sustainable society. With that, I think we should welcome him. A warm welcome to you, sir, and the floor is yours.
How long shall I speak?
You can take
45 minutes. Can you hear me? Okay. Then it's very simple. Well, thank you all very much for coming today. Though I'm not sure the talk would be worth it, let me start by saying. And particularly on such a rainy day to have taken the trouble and so on. But I think with whatever the quality of my talk, I think the subject, I hope to make it clear in the course of the argument, that the subject is of sufficient importance for almost all concerned citizens to be involved in. I mean it very seriously, and I mean it largely shape, it is shaping to a large extent, although indirectly, although you don't see it in the TV every day, but it is shaping the way our politics is being formed. It is shaping very indirectly the way parties get separated, even though they all agree on things like land acquisition, things like the model of development, and so on. So it's a subject which unknowingly you cannot really escape. Many of you are aware of it, many of you are unaware of it, and one of the purpose of this talk is to make you aware of, trying to make you aware of what it's all about, and where probably we can go in a different way, a few suggestions. Now before I, so let me start from the obvious. The obvious thing to start from is to say that if you think of urbanization, a big urban center around which there are surrounding various kinds of countrysides and villages and farmers, small, not so small, big and so on. The first thing which we all know, the most obvious thing, the urban sector provides a huge center of purchasing power, a huge market, and a diverse market which no isolated village could have ever given. That's obvious. But at the same time, along with this very diverse market and the possibility of selling goods, commercialization, and so on, it also does something which we do not see. The urban center takes from the village food, uses it for running the urban, whatever it is, the urban households and so on, for their consumption. But at the same time, something else happens all the time, and increasingly more. You see, originally economic theory, conventional economics, a few Nobel Prizes in economics, so on and so forth, like Arthur Lewis, all these were connected with saying how the food will come from the village to the city, the agricultural raw material will come to the city, how much you will get, and this used to be called the agricultural surplus needed for development. This was one of the conventional wisdoms of economics, how this will be collected, how this will be done. And as I said already, now what they did not do, and they also said that along with the food coming to the cities, there would be purchasing power which will be flowing to the villages, some of the people will be coming to the cities, will get industrial jobs and so on. And this is the sort of kind of world, relatively seamless, relatively frictionless, which is so told is how industrialization is proceed. But actually one of the most obvious things which we forgot in the process, and which is there in the history, many historians have written about it, Karl Marx wrote about it, many others wrote about it, it started with the British enclosure movement. This basically says that the urban areas not only requires food and so on from the villages of the countryside around, which feeds it and sustains it, and they provide job to the people who are displaced in the villages. But at the same time, the urban centers also need various, something very important. They need the natural resources of the countryside. And the natural resource is not only land, it is forest, it is mountains, it is water, one of the most increasingly important thing. It is the sea coast, it is a whole plethora of things, but most of which, as one Supreme Court judgment says, most of these things also require access to land. Natural resources, minerals, all of this. The city grows not only by taking food and giving purchasing power in exchange, but the city grows by also taking these other things which have a direct impact on rural livelihood. Now, this would not have been such a great problem. The conventional economist's idea of agricultural surplus and how to make development, how to make industrialization, would have had some validity if three things happened. And these are the things which very often you hear politicians, irrespective of which political party they belong to in India, bluffing. You hear the Chinese politicians bluffing, and you hear learned economists bluffing. Because the three things which you need to fulfill for this kind of a seamless or relatively effortless process to continue, let me say them in terms of importance. The first, the people whose livelihood would be adversely affected in various ways because these natural resources are needed, like if land is needed, we see it today, land acquisition. If coastline is needed, we see it today in the coastal law created a few years ago. If you need forest, the forest dwellers, whatever it is, in each and every case, the people whose lives are very badly being affected, if they found alternative employment through industrialization in the cities. This does not happen. So there is tension. You have much more of what you would call labor force growing. The people who are being displaced from the cities or being from the villages destroyed their livelihoods, but do not find corresponding jobs. This is called jobless growth. Okay. Now, why should it happen? It does not happen in most of traditional textbook economics in this way. Why does it happen in actuality? It happens because of a very simple reason. Again, I think a simple arithmetical example, you don't have to do algebra or anything. A simple arithmetical example would tell you offhand how it happens. Basically, because what happens in the villages, on the efficiency side, in the villages, it is true, productivity of labor, that is output per head of a, say, person engaged in agriculture, is much less than in the city. Actually, I calculated very recently, it is something of the order of 15 times more. If you take the organized industry and so on, anywhere between 15 to 23 times more in the, if you are engaged in a modern corporate sector, high productivity job, as opposed to a sort of average villager working in the village. So naturally, efficiency-wise, if you transfer people from the village to the city, this is absolutely true that you will have an enormous increase in output. Much of industrial countries' development, if you look at their economic history, was this transfer of labor which took place. I'll come back to it in a minute. But there is a downside to it. The downside to it is, suppose you take people from the village to the city, you employ them, they produce much more, they get better jobs, better salaries, better livelihood, so on and so forth. But at the same time, you provide only a few of them. Take a simple example. Suppose there are 10 people who are engaged in a village in agricultural activities. Each produces 2. So you are producing 10 people, 2 each, 20. Now, you have something like, take a modest figure, you have something like 6 times more. That is 12 in the cities, if you are involved in an organized industry in the city. Only 6 times more, as I said, it's much more usually, but 6 times more. So you produce 12, okay? Not, there you were producing 2, if you got transferred here in the city in an industrial work, you produce 12. Only 3 people are employed. How much you are producing? 30, 36. You lose the output of 10 people, which is 20, and you gain the output of 3 people in the cities, which is 36. That is exactly what happens. You have an 80% increase in output. But what happens to the 7 people who are unemployed? This is what causes jobless growth. You have a growth in output, but you do not have you have a stagnation, and very often worse than stagnation, in terms of employment. India grew from roughly from 1991-92 to till about 2008-9. So did China. At a rate, China around 9%, India around 7%. India's employment by official statistics in the organized sector grew by less than 1%. China's grew by 1.1%. So you had 8% growth in output, but you had only 1% growth in employment. Irrespective of the political system, irrespective of where you are, irrespective of the time. And this 7% growth came obviously from what exactly what I said, the increased output per worker in industry compared to agriculture. So basically the problem is, in a way, the problem of efficiency. Nobody would tell you that, least of all an engineer. But actually, if you're thinking of a social system, you have to think, after all, you are basically, everything is for human beings. And you do not want output because output is an inanimate thing. You want output because you want people to have it. And if you have so much of unemployment, only 3 people are employed, even if you give them high wages and so on, who are going to consume it? There is also this additional problem. So this is what happens in terms of jobless growth, which you say. This is high productivity of workers in industry, low productivity of workers in agriculture, but the number of people who can be absorbed in agriculture is not the number of people who can be absorbed in industry. Now, this is the problem. This is the problem is overlooked, sort of slighted in political statements of politicians, saying that most of you see TV, you open TV. Today, whoever it is, Arun Jaitley said we are growing at 6%, but we target to grow at 8% output. Somebody else says that, you know, India will catch up with whatever it is, with the West or with China in so many years because we will grow faster, China is growing slower. It's all a growthmanship. It's all in terms of growth of output. How many times have you heard a politician talking about the rate at which our employment is growing? We all know it from our personal experience of people around us, what sort of the job situation is and so on. And if you travel in India, if you travel to small towns, you see this very clearly. People who do not speak English. I mean, I mostly know North India and I know East India. I do not know the South. But in North India and in East India, almost, I can take a bet, anybody you see in a small town, do not speak English, studied up to class 12, job prospect almost zero. Statistical studies exist which say that if people are, you know, with same qualification, let's say graduate, who is within 5 years radius of a city, has exactly double the chance of earning income than that of a person in the village. There is a very beautiful and famous study done by 3 Indians but living in America. Now, these are the kind of things which happen. Now, the politicians bluff. And this is something which really is why I wanted first to say, and before I come to the small farmers. Politicians' bluff is to say, if output grows, things would be all right. And you have to wait a little bit, you have to sacrifice a little bit, because basically, isn't it England? England went through the same process. They also took land from the peasants and so on, enclosure movement. The same thing happened in America. They killed off many of the, you know, local natives, but so on. But still, they had to get huge amount of land and natural resources to start industrialization. Japan had to do it, Germany had to do it. But one thing which, if you do not know history, you tend to forget very quickly, is not that there were actually land had to be acquired in very often in violent ways, various kinds of violent ways, but something much more important. That is, England took approximately, depending on how you date the, you know, Industrial Revolution and so on, 100 to 140 years. depending on whether you with. Anyway, that's a matter of niceties. England took certainly more than 100 years to transfer most of their people to the cities. America took certainly 80 years or so to transfer people from the villages to the cities, largely. The case of Germany, I know Germany took something like 40, 45 years, the Ruhr Valley, the industrialization and so on. So the time scale needed for industry, for transferring people from villages to cities, this is the important thing. Transferring people from villages to cities, even if you grant all the assumptions of standard theory that people will be absorbed, people will have the skill, people will, is three generations for this to happen. Now, democracy has a time scale of 5 years. You have to win every 5 years, and your performance very often would be judged every 5 years. Not only in terms of corruptions and so on, but your performance would also be judged sooner or later in terms of whether you are able to provide people livelihood. Because beyond a point, if people are not provided livelihood, if small farmers lose their livelihood, where would they go? I mean, it still has not happened on that big a scale. But this time scale, this incompatibility of the time scale of a democracy and of industrialization is one of the worst kept secrets of so-called development economics. Because the two do not match. The two cannot go together. And increasingly you see it, and it is not a political question. It's a question which you see it is not a political question in the sense it is not a political question of one particular kind of political ideology. You see the problem in India, which I have seen. You see the problem in China, where there is increasing number of riots and so on over land acquisition, about people not being able to get sufficient jobs, particularly now. And you also see it in countries like Brazil and so on, which I have seen a little bit, and you see it quite clearly there when they try to industrialize faster. Because this is inevitable, and this is something which mostly these countries, the Western countries, which went through the industrialization, did not face because their democracy arrived along with their industrialization. It gradually, the both processes went together. In the case of India, it is quite different because we have democracy first. We value our democracy. But at the same time, if you value your democracy, you must find a way where you cannot say that growth is the only thing which matters. You have to find a way in which you have to at least have an employment growth which is a little bit higher than the growth of population so that you can gradually absorb the labor force and so on. And this is a challenge which India has failed. India has failed. No finance minister, no prime minister of any political party openly admits it, but this is where it has failed. Now, I do not want to talk about employment today, but I want to say this very firmly as a background, because this is what makes it most important to think of what will happen to the small farmers who form something anywhere between, depending on whom you consider small farmer, operational holding, ownership holding, et cetera, but basically anywhere between 40 to 60% of Indian populations would be directly or indirectly connected with this. And it is their fate which will determine to a large extent how our country shapes itself, how our democracy shapes itself over time. And this is why I think it is so important. This is where the connection is between the political system of our democracy and the economic system of just growth. We own growth and nothing else kind of attitude which will not work. Now, if you want to see the problem a little bit more positively, that is, what can we do? Well, obviously, we had experiments, we had thoughts. We had thoughts of people like great men like Mohandas Gandhi, Mao Zedong, so on and so forth, which very different political, you know, somebody said that the, what is it, gross blast furnaces in your backyards, that is Mao, Gandhi's idea of, you know, village India. None of these things actually seem to have been particularly workable or have worked so far. So from practical experience, from what we have seen and what actual surveys and so on do, if you have the imagination, what can you begin to have as a background to think of? And this is what I wanted to say, that this is merely in the form of what we can say as an alternative contour, very simply. We cannot say we don't want industrialization. This is romanticism and nobody will accept it. We cannot say that we'll, all that we grow in the cities will grow in the villages like Mao Zedong. It will not work. Now, what is it that we can do in between? For this, we have to understand what is sustainable in a village, of the village economy, what is equally what is not sustainable in the village economy. We have to make a demarcation. And let me start from there. When you increase purchasing power, when you create purchasing power in the cities and you expect the villages to provide for that market, you do, in several ways, you change the villages in terms of what you call commercialization. Now, commercialization is not one particular one process. It is several processes because it involves, it has several aspects. First, let me very quickly go through it. First, it will change the nature of the output you produced. That is what is called the output composition in the villages. Because if you want to produce from an urban market, you will not only produce the traditional grains, very often what you will not produce, and this is a little bit, little less true, I have been told by people like Sima and others, and I think this is largely true from my impression also, you will basically not produce one typical, very important thing, that is the rougher varieties of grains which you produced earlier. They will begin to disappear because for whatever reason, in urban areas, maybe because they are not profitable, because maybe because they are not touched by the green revolution, but you will not find, if you go to North India, if you go to East India, all the traditional varieties of rough rice, drought-resistant paddy, they have more or less disappeared. They now exist only for people, fashionable, I would not say, health-conscious, high-income groups who can buy this kind of special organic grains and so on and so forth. But basically, they have disappeared from the urban markets as a staple urban thing. And the downside of the Green Revolution, has this has been one of the biggest calamities of the Green Revolution. That is, it encouraged certain kinds of grains, certain kinds of, and it discouraged the traditional varieties which required less water, which very often could continue in drought conditions much better, survive much better. And there are plenty of examples of this. If you go to tribal areas, I have traveled in some of them, you still, if they give you something to eat, if they give you some rice to eat, you still find this, you know, what is called wild rice, very difficult to boil and so on, but which virtually requires as little water as maize, which requires very, very little water and grows under very hardy conditions. And this is what they have traditionally been used to. There are plenty of parts in Madhya Pradesh, there are plenty of parts in former Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and so on, where you still find this in only in those areas, this is the staple diet. But they have completely disappeared from cities. Now, this is just one example. So your grain composition will change, and it is continuously changing in favor of relatively high-income urban groups, making low-income people in the villages, not all villagers, but low-income people in the villages, very often life much more difficult because they themselves, unless they can grow these grains themselves to a certain extent, this will not be possible. This is one area. Second area, I just want to mention you. So the output composition is the first area where commercialization will make its dent. The second area where commercialization will make its dent is in terms of inputs. Two types of inputs are very important here, three types of inputs. The first is input of raw materials. What kind of fertilizer do you use? What kind of seed do you use? What kind of, and most of them increasingly are seeds which are purchased in the market. And if the government and the present government has its way, then, and its agricultural policy has its way, very soon you will have seeds which would be not only purchased from the cities, but it will be purchased from, it will be produced by large corporations like Monsanto and so on. And it will be used only for 3 years, fixed life, and after this, these seeds will not work. But that's very special. We will have seeds, raw materials, all of these pesticides, all of these which have to be purchased from outside. So in terms of your cost, your what you call your working capital cost, your cost of running a firm, the running cost of a firm will go up enormously in terms of money. Most of this in a villages were sustainable if you were doing it and were sustainable. It is true, like the arithmetical example I gave. They produced much less, but it was true that much of this was produced inside the village. The compost was produced inside the village. The so-called fertilizer was produced inside the village. The seed was produced inside the village. I mean, I'm not glorifying it, but I'm just saying that unless you are conscious how much of this you can retain and what you can improve there, you will actually not be able to sustain the small farmers. Then you come to the next important thing, labor, the most important input and the input for which you actually have development, which is also an input for agriculture. Now, with labor, the most important thing which happens that I do not know how much it happens in Karnataka or these parts of Karnataka around Bangalore city and so on, but generally in many parts of India, and the All India census and so on also shows it very clearly, that most small farmers are both. They are both farmers, they are both landlords. Even the very small farmer is a landlord in the sense that he has to hire in labor very often at the peak of the agricultural season. He also gives out labor. He also works on somebody else's farm as a wage labor, depending on when he has less work. In parts of North India, there was a system, you know, where the peasant cultivator was much more common. That is the Raithwari system and so on. They developed the tradition of Raithwari system. You know the Jats, about whom you read so much in the newspapers and the Jat agitation and so on. They had this bhaiyachar, which basically meant that I work on your field, you work on my field at a certain time when the, you know, what do you call, when the, it still goes on in parts of West UP, I'm told, that when the time of harvesting comes, you have to do this. Now, this leasing in and leasing out is one of the ways in which, to some extent, you soften the inequality of land ownership, right? Because even if you don't own the land, you can use partly your labor by just leasing in and leasing out. But there is another way which I think consciously we should be thinking of, and there's the survey around which we are having this lecture and I am here and so on and so forth. One of the things which you see, but whose significance I think neither politicians nor economists in India still understand, is what in Japan they used to call the worker peasant. You know, the communists used to call it the worker peasants alliance, Lenin. But the worker peasant of the Japan is a very different one. That is, Japan maintained for a very long time the worker peasant, the peasant who, somebody who had land in the village, produced in the village, somebody else, but also worked in the factory in the city. And in critical times, he or part of the family would go back and would look after the land. Japan maintained with a very modernized industry and modern sector and so on, something like 10 to 15% of its labor force in agriculture until very recently. After the, you know, very recently something has happened to it. But anyway, they maintained something like 15% of the 10 to 15% of the labor force because of this thing that people derive their land both from, derive their income both from agriculture and from industry. This happens much more in India. If you check, you will see that many of the people who work in the cities also either through remittances or through part-time, part of the time, go back to the village to the work. I think this is something which has to be particularly encouraged. Employment policies, not only in terms of taxes and so on, should actually encourage this. Just like, you know, we at one stage we recommended that schools should not hold their examinations at the time of the harvesting and the time of the sowing because children help the parents. I remember that was one of the first studies which we did and recommendation which I made. Similarly, I think this is a very simple thing to do, that to tell factories to encourage employment of this type and give leave at the time when they need really to go back to the villages and so on. It's a very simple thing to organize, as I said, for like examinations in schools. But this is something which is an idea which is worth pursuing, and it will to some extent help in stabilizing agriculture. Now, this is so far as labor is concerned at the minor scale without land reform, because all these things are not in the political agenda and probably not a great idea at the moment either. The third thing is for input, which is capital, but the most important thing is credit. Now, one of the most disastrous things which have been done, I mean, many of you must have been reading. I read and I think, well, this is the country we live in. Hundreds and hundreds of discussion with so many people saying, was Mr. Rajan's going a bad thing or a good thing? Was Mr. Rajan a, you know, the Reserve Bank governor? Was he a good economist or a bad economist? These are not the relevant issues. These are of very minor significance in India compared to some of the biggest issues, like what did he do with credit reform? Or not only what did he, what a Reserve Bank governor is able to innovate or do in terms of rural credit, what they're able to do in something else. You see, unless we bring these issues, and this is partly the work of media, of a responsible media or imaginative media, unless we are able to bring these issues and academics and others as the most important issues in the country, just saying that, you know, 3 lakhs farmers have committed suicide over the last 10 years, this will not help. These are really newsworthy items. But if you really want to do, you know, how much credit reform, rural credit reform has taken place? Nothing. If you look at what this goes under the name of economic reform, it has gone exactly the other way. I don't have the detail to go into it, but if you look at the economic, the reform agenda, it has gone exactly the other way of reducing the possibility of loan for farmers, small farmers, who have virtually no collateral to offer, rather than giving it on the other side, in the name of cutting down on government expenditure and so on, reducing extension service, so on and so forth. There is a fourth area where commercialization takes place and which almost is never talked about, commercialization of agriculture, I want to tell you. And this is commercialization of knowledge. We all know commercialization of knowledge exists in terms of, you know, soil testing, in terms of you have to use modern agricultural technology. This is the whole extension service. But how many of you have thought of it the other way around? That is, there is also traditional knowledge in the villages. I mean, except for a few fashionable NGOs and so on, that there is also traditional knowledge in the, you know, in the villages. And how much of this, because they are not commercialized, many of them are, you know, common property resource. Many of them, because nobody has a, you know, property ownership on it, they are not considered knowledge which are worth talking about. including Azim Premji University. I do not know which tries to be innovative in some ways, and I am one of their guests. So, but I do not know whether this is at all seriously considered as a way of thinking of how much of this can be used for the farmers who, not only used, how much of the, if a farmer, suppose a farmer has the knowledge of a traditional grain, say paddy, which is drought resistant, extremely needed in North Karnataka, even more needed in parts of UP, parts of, how much of us think that which is the way in which this farmer can be rewarded for having preserved through all odds this variety of seed? There is nothing in the country. There is nobody even thinks of how to, you know, how to create a system of reward which will actually help at an individual level this kind of incentive. And it is not a very difficult thing. I mean, you have rewards for all kinds of rubbishy economics and so on and so forth. But you do not have rewards for this kind of actual things which is on the ground possible, you know. Now, this is, so far as commercialization of agriculture is concerned, and agricultural commercialization basically means commercialization of the product, that is the grains and so on and so forth, commercialization of the inputs, commercialization of credit. You increasingly go to credit for, well, anyway, I would not go into all this. The credit market, you commercialize labor in terms of, they were automatically input, you know, lease in, lease out of land. But the new dimension which we can develop is the worker present syndrome. And finally, there is most important and least talked about is commercialization of knowledge. It only one kind of knowledge which goes from the city to the village and on which property rights can be established of those who invented the property. The opposite is never tried. During this commercialization, one very important thing which has happened, and there is enough of individual service from all over India which is available, which shows two things on an average. It is the fast depletion of common property resources. It is not only the high profile, you know, Niyamgiri which is going, or high profile, you know, sea coast of Madras which is going, but it is also very generally all the commons. The first attack of when you take land away from the villages, the easiest thing to take away is the village commons. Because the village commons basically does not belong to anybody but the government, so the government very easily can take out. And the depletion is supposed to have been more than 60% in the more than last 10 years. I don't know how reliable the statistics is, but this is something you hear in sort of so-called active civil societies who talk about these things. I don't know. Usually do not do much research, but it goes around that. But anyway, they say more than, you know, somewhere around 2/3 of the commons have been depleted very, very quickly in the last 1 to 1.5 decades. Now, the meaning of this for the poor is very seldom emphasized. In extreme cases, again, the high-profile case, in the case of forest rights, you see it. Because if the forest goes, those who live on the forest, they go. I mean, it's as simple as that. But when the commons resources goes, there is something else which happens. The figure is, the average figure, I have seen at least 8 to 10 studies, the average figure, surveys that is, average figure for the poorest section, that is at lowest 20-25% in a village, in terms of sustenance of their livelihood and income, however you calculate it, is somewhere around 1/3. That is, if you go to the poor, I mean, I have seen studies from Orissa, that is village service from Orissa. I have seen it from Chhattisgarh. I have seen it from Jharkhand. I have seen it from Madhya Pradesh. That the average figure and the overall impression you get is that something like 1/3 of income, not necessarily money income, but 1/3 of their whole income source of calories, so on, and everything included, 1/3 of it is supported by village commons. So you can imagine when the in the lowest bottom 20-25% of the population, when their income goes, when the commons goes, how hit they are. It is much more than being hit in terms of not having a school for the children, not having a hospital and so on. It means that you don't have your next meal. It is as simple as that. You don't have your next meal. And these are very often the people who are at the forefront. And again, I speak from experience, who are people who are in the forefront when it comes to land acquisition. It is not acquisition of private property. It is acquisition of public property by the public for the private. That is, the government takes over the common property, saying that you are out of it, and now then gives it to some X, Y, or Z corporation. And this is where you find the biggest resistance and the most militant resistance, because it is their next day's food. It is their next meal, very often. And this widely exists in Orissa, this widely exists in Chhattisgarh, this widely exists anywhere else. Now, this is one of the most vulnerable aspects of commercialization. You know, you hear of things which are very important, but which are less relevant. That is, land is taken away, how much compensation would you get? Whether the compensation is fair or not, very important. But you know, for every one of the many of the areas where that thing has taken place, everyone who has property, any form of property in land, there are 3 to 4 people, my calculation is 4, 3 to 4 people who do not have. They are the fishermen, they are the boatmen in Narmada, they are the people who are the, you know, tenants, they are the people who are the agricultural workers, they are the people who are the pulling the cart to take it to the local market in terms of villages. These are the people who are at the ratio of 1 to 3. And when land is taken away, it is these people who actually are not even considered for compensation. Nobody even thinks of them for compensation. It's a rule of private property. That if you have the property, if you have the property right, you get it. If you don't have the property right, even if you're making a livelihood out of this, you are out. You go and die. Now, this is where actually things have got. The whole land acquisition bill is very often barking up, I mean, is targeting the wrong thing. Because it is actually thinking of land as property, which is true. But around that property of land, there is an entire system, if one might exaggerate, an entire civilization of people who make different kinds of livelihoods. You see this very clearly when you travel in areas like Narmada, around the this Medhapatkar's movement, or when you see that whole group of people of very, very diverse origin, even though the basic movement is for them, those who will get it, the land acquisition and so on. But there are a whole group of people, the fishermen, the boatmen and so on, where would they go? You know, if there is a dam, where would they go? I mean, they are not even considered for compensation. They are not even considered for as human beings, you know, whose lives are worth anything. Now, this is what is actually we have to prevent if we have to. I mean, when we say that we have to make the small peasants' economy survive, don't narrow your imagination by saying the peasant basically means a man who gets up in the morning, or the woman goes to the, cultivates a field, has his own little land. It is not the Do Bigha Jamin, if you have seen that famous film of Bimal Raya and so on. It is not only that you have that little bit of land. And this is the poetry of the village. But actual village is not only these people, but the whole surrounding livelihood nexus, which exists almost in any village community. Until your industrialization is, and I don't think this was a problem, which was true. It was certainly not true in America after the, I don't know what it was, before the, the Indian Americans were sort of driven out of the land. But certainly this was not a problem which America faced. This was not a problem in this form which England faced. This is a problem which India faces. because this is a problem of a highly populated country, overpopulous country, in which actually around land, so many livelihood has to be found. And when you talk of survival of a small peasant, you have to think of their survival not only of the peasant, but what the peasant supports. You see, when you come to the city and you work for a large firm, when you work for an Ambani or for a Jindal or I don't know, God knows whom, when you work for, you are fending for yourself. You are being treated as a wage laborer, you are fending for yourself, you are only responsible to your boss for providing the profit and for it to yourself for getting your wages. When you are living in the village, you are doing the same, but you are creating the external economy. And this is something which very few people realize, even those who, and this is something which over and over again needs to be said. And in this context, I want to say one more thing about land acquisition, and then I'll come to the last point. That is, you see, so when you do land acquisition, is there a general rule which we can follow? Or a general, not rule, general guideline that we can follow? I think there is one. And there is one which is connected with the fact that when you acquire land, I mean, apart from the usual thing which very often people say, and I'm sure you know, that there should be consent of the village, it should be decentralized and so on, which we all the time say. I also say, we all say all the time. But there is something more. There is a certain kind of land acquisition, which very often earlier used to be called state-driven industrialization, which Bamsi was talking about yesterday. State-driven industrialization, where actually you used it to build railroads, highways, basically to improve connectivity of the village. Okay. Or the marketability of the product of the village for various kinds of things for the villages to move. Now, those things which are helpful to the village also, not only to the industry but also to the village, are something which I think at first round should be accepted. At the first round, things which are not at all of advantage to the village, like you would be shocked to hear, for example, mining. A very highly valued activity and so on. But in this country, I mean, in this part of India, if you have traveled to Bellary and so on, you would know what I'm talking about. Where the mining took place in the Reddy brothers and so on, and that what they did to the land. You travel there and you see. Basically, in those kind of mining, I think there has to be a solution where the village must get its share. And the only way in which this can happen is for them, if they keep the ownership of the land, which repeatedly I have said, and I think I firmly believe this is the only possible solution. They keep ownership of the land, but they give it for rent for 50 or 99, or it does not even have to be 99 years, 50 years, because very few, mines survive over 50 years. So they will get a regular rent, and it is true they will cease to be peasants and they will be rentiers, but then there is some possibility that around they can do some other activity. And they will, the housing and so on, in which form the rent would be given is another matter. Together with this, I think there is a second suggestion that every time you give land to industrialists, I mean, if you are hell-bent that industrialization should proceed through large corporations and so on, and this is a politics which I at least do not think I can influence very much. Not only I don't think we can influence very much anywhere in the world, because this seems to be the digit of the age. But anyway, if this is the way it is going to go for the time being, what we can insist and we can get, I still believe that we can actually get it, is to say that the village, the corporations which do this, which get this, must not only do give in compensation, land and so on and so forth, but there is something else which they must do. The area from which they are taking the natural resource, like for example, if you're taking electricity, you must provide house with electricity there. You see Odisha and you see what I mean. You take over hundreds of kilometers by transmission line, but deprive precisely those areas where the electricity is being generated to give it to the factory. You go to Gujarat, you see the same thing in Narmada. I mean, I have seen it myself. You take it to Gandhinagar, but you would not give it to the farmers around because it is meant for industry. This must not be allowed. That is part of, if you take natural resources, the benefit of the natural resources must partly be in the village. And this must be a part of Land Acquisition Act. It is nowhere there. Nowhere there is the fact that there are people who are not owner of land who stay there. Nowhere is there the fact that people whose livelihood is being uprooted totally, is being destroyed because natural resource has to be extracted, that they should get part of the, if electricity is generated there, if water is generated there, you know, if you are going to build a dam and take the water, then the dam must not be taken just in pipe, as it is done, including, you know, so many, including in the Krishna River, and there are so many places where I can mention this is done, that they take it out in a pipe and it is straight delivered to the industry 50, 60, 100 kilometers away, and the villages are purged. They even don't get the water which they used to get before. This sort of transfer of natural resources for the benefit of industry by totally depriving the village should not be allowed. It must happen that if there is a production which is being generated of electricity, of water and so on, the village must get piped water. This would be part of the job of the corporation to do it. It would be part of the land reform. It is not only compensation for this. Unless we can bring this out, unless this kind of changes are going to take place, not only Indian economy and so on, I mean, whatever is the statistics of your growth rate and so on, Indian economy would be in a bad state, Indian people would be in a bad state, Indian statistics might look better and better over time, but Indian people would be in a bad state. But what is also what I am frightened of is we will change our democracy, because you will not win election on this. As you will see very soon, if you don't deliver on these things, if you destroy livelihood, it will change our democracy permanently. It will hijack our democracy, where it will basically be only for a few who will directly benefit from that. Thank you. Shall I keep this?
So now we will open the session for questions and comments and clarifications, if any.
You want to ask?
There is one question. One here, one there. So can you see one, two? Here.
Everybody is welcome to ask questions, but don't expect me to have knowledge to answer it satisfactorily. Only on that condition. Okay, start.
So thank you very much for your talk. Just had this question about, you referred about the traditional knowledge in villages. And you gave example about, you know, the grain that could probably survive several years. So are there any other examples of this knowledge that is resident in the villages? Are there more examples of this that one can think about? Is there a documentation?
I know of some examples which I can give.
Sure.
Well, one example is traditional water management. You know, I don't work in that area, but I know that people who have succeeded have not succeeded by doing completely modern water management. People like Rajinder Singh and so on who have succeeded. Very often when they have succeeded in very dry areas, they've succeeded because they revived in some form with popular participation the old systems of how to manage water, how to store water, manage water, I mean, all that it means. That this is something which is one traditional area. Now, this is something which, for example, no irrigation department would buy. You know? Now, and it, you require people, so-called, you know, oddballs like Rajinder Singh or somebody else, who will say, no, this is the way, I will show it, this is the way to do it. You know, even Nana Hazare. The most of them did water management, bonds and so on, depending on this. There's a second thing, and which I wanted to talk about, but I was running out of time, I didn't say. You know, in the many of the traditional villages, you were from Andhra, no? You were talking about from Andhra. If you read the old history, both of Andhra and of part of Sri Lanka, the what they used to call the hydraulic society, that is still about the 17th century. Many anthropologists, social anthropologists and so on have worked on this, including Edmund Leach and others, famous ones. One of the things which they used to do is they will give the the land, you know, and very often the land will belong to the high caste people, the low caste people will get, if at all they have land, they will get it far away and so on. But one of the things which they would do is the water management control would be in the hand of a low caste person. It was a very, very widely prevalent practice. I have forgotten the name, but there was a name of a certain caste which actually was given the task of much of South India, even in Sri Lanka. And that the people who are otherwise unprivileged, underprivileged, that so that they're not so disprivileged that they would not get any water at all, probably. And they would rise in revolt and so on. Whatever the reason is, I don't know the motive, but the control of the water was not in the hand of an administrator or an upper caste person or the village landlord's employee or something like that. It was in the hand of a lower caste person. Now, this is this way of balancing, you know, to some extent, is something which traditional societies always managed to do, tried to do, to keep things under control. I mean, caste system would exist, caste untouchability would exist, all the rubbish, you know, all the awful things will go on with it, but at the same time, we'll try to create a balance so that it does not go out of hand. Now, we don't have to accept the other part of it, but the notion of how to create the balance in traditional society, this is another example. I could give you many more examples. There is example of storage, there is example of storing water, but that will take too long, but I just give you two outside.
Exciting to hear and exciting to interject with you. Two comments and one question. Can you stand all these three or it's too much?
Why don't you come here?
No, I cannot give you. The comment is on the commons. I think you hit upon the major question. How to protect the commons, but in the rural economics framework. Unfortunately, both the state and the people have failed in dealing with commons. State thinks that it is at zero marginal cost available to them because of the state power, eminence of the power, domain power. The people of the villages do not value it as a public good problem, you know, tragedy of the commons. So we have in both, when both institutions fail, community as a community, one group, as state as a, you need an agency to bring in some institutional framework to see that the people are made responsible. That agency is not in the Constitution of India, firstly. It is not even in any other framework of the administration. Civil administration. This is my comment. Related question is, the state acquires, this is related to land acquisition. State acquires land and for very various purposes, as you rightly pointed out, for laying of the railways for the villagers, roads for the villagers, or canals for the villagers, and so on and so forth. But they acquire much more than what is really required, with the result They sell it back to the private agencies, corporate sectors. This has happened with Bangalore Airport, with those of you are familiar with famous PIL, which is still pending in the Supreme Court of India, on the acquisition of the, what is this airport called? This is a Kempegowda airport. It has happened in Hubli Airport. They acquired 900 hectares of land. They needed only 600 hectares of land. They sold the remaining land, acquisition at the, as per the land laws, as per the DC or the commissioner, selling at the corporate level. So this is where the state makes unusual regarding rent. So this has been, is not seen in the land acquisition or the permanent property resource. About mining, since I happen to be a mining writer on this subject, the problem there is a bill still pending in the parliament about mining act to give a share of the profit back to the land owners. But the so-called land owners are not willing to take that share for the reason that there are vested groups, Naxalites in Jharkhand, mafias in Karnataka, Bellary, you mentioned Bellary. I did field work in Bellary. I remember the mafias were operating there. Right. So they are working such that the 29%, it is actually under the land bill, the mining bill, 29% of the profit should go to the land owners of the mines. They are not willing to accept it because the mafia will lose their share. So this is where the state again fails in implementing mining bill. Now, can I pose a question? Question is about, you began very well on this question, on the topic as a difference in productivity, land productivity or agriculture productivity vis-a-vis industrial productivity, which you very vehemently illustrated the difference and the why the plight is taking place, migrations and so on. But I think we have, in our domain of thinking of development, we have not thought of value added of a farmer or farming community or if, agriculture practice vis-a-vis industrial practice. Now, there is a difference in value added per capita or per labor force. But as you know, from primary production to the higher level of production, the value added ratio increases. At the farmer's level, value added may be maybe 5% profit, 10% profit, or survival, as it is known as in classical economic thinking. But in service sector, the profitability 1,000 times. So the value addedness is very high. Now, how do you add value addedness to the farming community is my question. Primary productivity has a very low value added per unit of labor. My suggestion for your consideration is transfer some of the value added activities related to agriculture to the village economies. And it is possible in a large country like ours. I give you examples. Those of you are familiar with the pomegranate being grown in Bagalkot district in Karnataka, or grapes being grown in Bijapur district. I think you did the field work there. That's why I remembered you. But the processing is not taking place in Bijapur. It is sold at the primary level. So the real benefit of the value addedness by the farming community is going to Hyderabad, is going to Mumbai. Parleys are operating from Mumbai. The pomegranate is processed in Bangalore. So this is where we fail in adding value addedness to the farming community. What are the options that you have? How the state can intervene to see that if an industry is producing X amount of produce, farm-based produce, they must produce 80% of it in the village economy only. Can it be done then? This is my question.
Can I react quickly to each of them? Yes. Well, let me, because on each one of them, I have a very short addition to make. So far as village commons are concerned, I think you know what I said about water and the old way of water management with a broadcast person very often in charge, you know. The similar thing, if you try to manage commons with a government committee, even at the local level, I don't think it will work for the reasons which you have said, because of public goods, nobody values. Government does not value because it comes free, because it automatically belongs to it. I think what will happen is if you get one of those who are really derive their income, if you put them in charge of protecting the common, that under what conditions they will allow the common to be used for some other purpose, a committee where they have a substantial representation, these people who get one third of their income from the commons, I think you will have a fair chance of success. They're not only a reward system, they would be part of the decision-making system. And they will get the reward only if the commons remains automatically. I think we have to think along those lines. Just like in the case of water, it used to be in earlier times. Now, on your second thing on the value added, I don't have anything on the other. On the value added, I think it is on the food processing. I think you're absolutely right. What I said about the worker-peasant combination, which worked very well, seemed to have worked very well in Japan and in much of Southeast Asia. I think it is really an extension of the argument, but except for the fact that processing industries, including food processing, if they can be done in the villages, they would be wonderful and they will add a lot of value. But I think they require, like everything else, preconditions. Uninterrupted electricity, water, which the cities get. If once you have given them in the villages, you have won the battle. I mean, people like me shouting is no longer needed. You know? I think your idea is a very good one. I think we all would agree. But its feasibility in terms of processing industries. You know, even when they took things like sponge iron, they took out all the water. I mean, you go to Odisha, they took out all the water of the rivers for the farmers, not only polluted it and so on, they took it out in such a large scale, you know, for the sponge iron factory that these villages became uncultivable. Now, with the processing industry, you have to provide the necessary prerequisites at the village level or at least at the district level and so on. And this, I think, well, it is certainly feasible. I think it is feasible. But the first part of the feasibility is what I already said. That's my second comment. That when you have the land acquisition built into it, the fact that if some mineral is being extracted for use, you know, part of it must remain in the village. You know, one of the things when we were traveling, I said, and I mean to very ordinary people, villagers and so on, and which got a wonderful reception, one of my friends, but got nothing when I said it in JNU or Goa or anywhere else, you know, to a university crowd, is the fact that when I said that, you know, if you have iron, and I even decided to write a short paper on it, I'll send it if you like. Like when you extract iron, because you know it's very huge iron mining area. If you take iron, make sure that some of this iron is used here not as a bullet, because you know there is also Maoist activity and so on. Not as a bullet, but this iron is used here to build the houses, part of the houses. And you know, I don't think I have made, I mean, I said it often, but I don't think I have ever made a comment which went down so well, because they neither liked the Maoists, nor do they like the, and they liked even less, the corporations which are taking away that. This was in Jharkhand, you know. That's right. I mean, you know, you have miles and miles, if you have any house, they are only burnt houses in Jharkhand. And you see all these are open iron mines, which are being, iron is being taken God knows where, without a single iota being left to be locally used. Well, that is partly the beginning of the value. I think value added starts there. The third thing which I wanted to say, which is about your comment about, you know, your question about the value added proper and doing it in the cities and so on, whether we can do it. I think, you know, one of the things which we can start very simply, particularly for small firms, which is the focus of, is by reducing cost. I mean, the typical management school training, which says that if you cannot do anything else, reduce cost. And you see it all over Europe today. I want a lean and hungry corporation. Half of the workforce out, half of this out, and so on. But here it is not half of the workforce out. But what you do is you try to stop as much as possible, you know, commercialization of the inputs. That's for small firms, one of the real disasters, even for middle firms, I believe has really been the extraordinary increase in the working capital cost compared to the output. Well, anyway, we can discuss it. I have some data if you want to see. I will show you from different parts. You wanted to ask something. There is...
Hi, myself Arindam from Sustainable Engineering Labs of Columbia University. It was my work on smart, if you know UN SDG smart irrigation goals, that was my work which became part of those goals. I have the reason, the questions that I want to ask are not questions but complaints about the economic policies of India in this field. First, I'll start with a general introduction that it was my organization. I have the privilege of having an organization which was first banned by Modi in 2007, like the JNU thing. And lately, even most of the Swachh Bharat campaign is using the product that we have designed as part of Columbia University, which is an open source product and $500 million is invested on open source projects in India, which is basically an economic loss. So when I came back to India, what I'm trying to do is try to actually stop those nexuses which is building up in this sector. And
stop the building of?
The nexus that is, stop the investment that is coming to sectors which are like, I can give you examples of companies like Practo, I Change My City, all are built on open source products, which is my work. Now I come back to India, it's like the FDI retail was coming in, I was consulting PepsiCo, Del Monte with PAU and putting up India's first solar smart grid in Gujarat. None of those projects were successful because there's a different political mindset that goes on.
Can you come here? I cannot quite clearly understand what you're saying.
So when FDI retail was coming in India and I was consulting PepsiCo and Del Monte in Punjab Agriculture University, trying to get something for the farmers. But that political mileage never came through. So what we have figured out with the UN SDG coming in is come up with the concept of green village. The thing that I am stuck is a policy which most economists in India are still stuck with the Mahalanobis way of operations where the industries is going to pay for the rural resources. But I belong to this Jeffrey Sachs school, which talks about ecological services have to be market oriented. Now, this is a struggle which is there where when we take up climate change and where aspects of water as a commons, can solar be a commons in this country where you can actually install solar power plants in agriculture farms and sell it to the grid and give the farmers the extra income. This is something which we have been trying. We have been trying to get investment. I'm incubated in DST, but nobody understands this concept because the very idea of water as a commons is not taken up. Nobody is going to pay for the pay for water in India. And this is going to be a major crisis in the future.
Water would be a major crisis. But what is its connection with solar?
So what we are trying to do is,
change the nature of irrigation.
Yeah, smart irrigation, solar smart irrigation system that we have designed in a way that in climate change, what we say is it rains less often, but when it rains, it pours. And the monsoon is going towards the September era. So there's always a demand-supply shift, which is there for irrigation, which is actually affecting the the economics of the village. And that's why most of the people are committing suicide. It's nothing to do with many of these government policies. The very idea of this whole idea is not taking up because people are still expecting the state to invest into the village scenarios, which we have seen for the last 50 years is not happening. So that's my question as an economist. Are we still thinking in the lines of, because it's easier to do things in Africa, but not in India?
It's a very difficult question to answer precisely, but I'll just tell you what I think in a nutshell. When we think of agricultural policies, except agriculture prices and so on, even there, but much more when we think of technology, when we think of extension service and so on, it is invariably what the city and in particular what big industry will get out of it. Now, it is not a question of mindset. It is also a question of politics. This is the way the politics of this country is. And this is why, people like you mentioned Jeffrey Sachs and so on. I think basically one of the problems is, just like in America, you cannot today talk about American democracy without talking about where the funding comes from. And you have seen how Clinton won over, Sanders and so on. But you can very clearly, you cannot think of an economic policy which would be feasible, in which the government would be interested, which is not of interest to corporations. That is the bottom line, so far as the government is concerned. And this government, the Congress government, Manmohan Singh, Narendra Modi, there is no difference in this respect. Similarly with land acquisition. When in opposition you were one, when in power you were exactly the opposite. It will be exactly the same. So you see, there is an overall umbrella politics which is in this country. And part of the job of the civil society is to say these things are possible. And partly to gain confidence at a much lower level to try something feasible, like you were mentioning, I don't know the exact technology which you are talking about. I probably would not even understand it unless I see it. That if you are talking about solar energy and drip irrigation, that sort of a combination, which was one of the favorite things of Jeffrey Sachs, I know, that if it is that sort of thing you are thinking of, then it is something which you can only do at a local level. I have been interested in storage of grains enormously for the last 5, 7, 10 years, since I started traveling in Indian villages. I know of various things which traditionally was done. They store reasonably, but only for 6 months, 7 months during certain seasons, etc., etc. But the point is, nobody is interested. So if anybody wants to do it, they have to do it themselves and show it at a local level that this can be done and then hope for the best. I'm sorry, I cannot be more optimistic than this in the present scenario.
Amita, I never thought I would live to see the day when you started sounding as Gandhian as you've sounded today. Because, really, did the old man in the end have his hand on or his eye on a kernel of truth that was so important that and that has been dismissed, completely written off in the sense that you're saying. And in that context, I think I just would like a clarification about two things which in some ways in your talk, I think I lost track of the distinction between them. One is there is obviously a primitive accumulation going on of, on a massive scale in places where there is, where you have tribals, where there's minerals and so on and so forth. But at some level, we know and don't know. We know the answer to that. We don't know how to do it or to make it happen simply because it is such naked power in the political economy that's at work. But the more tricky question is the one where you don't have all of that, where you don't have minerals sitting under the land, where people, where farmers are not being dispossessed of soil, of land itself for that reason, but where it's much more the traditional commons where poor people graze their animals and, you know, minor produce is picked up important for subsistence. And I think that is the more complex question, which is where, in some senses, I felt you were sounding Gandhian. So what are you saying here that is different from what someone who called himself a Gandhian economist perhaps might say?
Well, I think that two questions.
Leave the trappings aside.
You know, I started, I guarded myself by mentioning two names, if you remember. One is Gandhi and the other is Mao. They both had their solution for the villages. I think Gandhi's basic problem and why, I mean, what I am is not particularly important, but why I find Gandhi very unpersuasive in certain aspects is not in his identification of the problem, but in his incomplete identification of the problem. For this, as a book you read, In the Shadow of the Mahatma by G.D. Birla, that you see, while Gandhi said all these things about the villages and so on, but actually where to put big industry, he was totally silent on. In terms of existing industries. I mean, at the level of, you know, I mean, this is my vision of Hinsaraj, this is my vision of India and so on. It all, I mean, today, of course, with the advantage of time and so on, we can all write an essay on this. But the issue is how to deal with the enormous power of the corporations, rising power of the corporations, which was probably not so important at that time. At least not in India, because, you know, overpowering imperialism and so on. But anyway, this was something which is totally absent both from Gandhi and from Mao. And this is our stark reality, increasingly, in shaping our democracy, in shaping our politics and so on. I don't have to go into this, as you said. Now, when I was talking about the traditional, you know, knowledge, when I was talking about the crops which have been lost, I mean, the kind of grains which have been lost in the process and which, if we can regain, it will sustain the village. It was precisely about that problem which Gandhi addressed. And I think he addressed absolutely the right problem. That is, how to make village economy more sustainable. Because we have no other choice. You know, maybe when you were a student and I was first teaching in Delhi school, we both were much younger, and in a certain way, I thought I knew the answer. That age of innocence has certainly gone, so far as I'm concerned. I'm being absolutely honest. That age of innocence has certainly gone. I certainly know that today in India, you cannot solve the problem of livelihood of a very large number of people, of the, you know, without having some solution about how to deal with the village economy. And how to deal, the way the governments, irrespective of the color, are dealing with the village economy is not a solution but a disaster. To that extent, I'm a Gandhian. But that does not mean that the village economy is the one which I support.
Thanks for an insightful talk. So a couple of questions are bothering me for some time, and you raised those questions again. In literature on transformation issues of rural world into an urban and industrializing world, there's already a growing body of literature, though on the margins, which is talking about another peasant turn in imagining future. They are either sociologists or some disillusioned economist or economists who are from heterodox tradition. And they are already talking about some kind of a, because overpopulation is a, on the rural side, is a problem in many parts of the world. Africa is also facing that kind of a problem. And some political experiences in countries like Venezuela and also Zimbabwe, they have gone for fragmenting land and distributing it to peasantry in a big way. So they are thinking of re-peasantization. There's a possibility of re-peasantization. And possibility in terms of possibilities of re-peasantization, it looks to be very difficult proposition at this point of time because the political support for this kind of an idea is sadly missing at a global level. Also because the charm of the capitalist economy and the kind of support behind it is such that it will not have that kind of support. Even the cooperative movement has miserably failed. But we have example of a cooperative milk industry doing well, doing value addition properly. Also kind of it's a peasant model of industrial production, I would rather say. And so possibilities of such collectivization, I see where there is a demand in the urban sector or urban area, because even the milk industry succeeded, cooperative milk industry succeeded because there was a demand for milk production or milk as a product or other milk related products in urban areas. The familiar saying for growth of Amul is that since there was a Bombay, Amul really grew up and sustained itself for initial two decades. And so I am just curious to hear from you that what other possibilities of collectivization for a new imaginative mode of peasantry coming together and producing. In case of just one last point, in case of a cooperative milk industry, the producers might not have been contiguous. They are small farmers, they have contributed to a same kind of a same place, milk has been collected and sold, returns have flowed back to them of value addition. But are there possibilities of collectivization of farming? Do you see any such possibilities happening in India or even anywhere else in the, at a global level?
Well, I don't know, but let me just say what I know. You know, this whole notion of deep representization started as a political program. It did not start as an economic program, because both in the Soviet Union, former Soviet Union, and in China, the collectivization of agriculture, I mean, in Russia it was a disaster, in China it was not a great success, and in 1981-82 they changed. But the political program in China from inside the Communist Party of China, in Russia it was from outside when the Soviet system was beginning, was to say that we want re-peasantization. But it was a completely pipe dream, because people, once they have lived in cities or in other occupations and so on, it is not so easy. Like everything else, you have to learn to be a peasant. You have to be, if not born, at least you have to learn to be a peasant and a successful peasant and so on. And this was actually representation movement, both by written by sort of several academics and by several, you know, political people in the 1990s, basically, was actually at that time, because it was disappointment with collectivization result and to a certain extent to reaction to the Soviet, the Stalin's offensive against the kulaks and all the rest of it. Now, if you are talking of success, I think two of the biggest successes I know, one is in India, which is the Amul, the Anand, and so on and so forth. But it is like land reform. I am not sure that collective production, collective I don't mean in the sense of socialist collective or you know cooperatives in terms of the property ownership or something of that sort. Coming together is a multidimensional concept. I'm sorry I use the big word, but you know, it is a concept which has many aspects, because you can come together for marketing. You can come together for buying seeds. You can come together, like in the Grameen Bank, for taking loans, you know, sort of group loans. You can come together for many, many ways. You define what is the togetherness. I think one of the failures has been to think of whether it is, you know, cooperatives. Cooperative is a cooperative from of everything, except for the fact that you don't lose your land in a, like in a collective, private ownership of the land. Everything else is cooperative. And as you know, the little I have read about Amul, it kept on changing. About, you know, this Ila Bhatt scheme. She was, being a lawyer, she was very clear about it from the very beginning. I have only once had a chance to talk to her. And she was very clear that she was the one who mentioned that there is nothing called a cooperative. There is cooperation in particular aspects. And I think she was dead right. This was many years ago. I didn't fully understand what she was saying. I mean, in concrete terms. But I think this is something which you should remember. That there is nothing, at least in today's world, not only because there is corporate interest and so on, but to start on an all-embracing cooperative is like starting on an all-embracing land reform. Land reform alone is not enough. You have to do credit reform. You have to do market reform, blah, blah. And if you don't do them, they will not succeed, you know. Similarly, with cooperatives, I think it is very clear that depending on the problem at hand, you decide on which aspect of cooperation is the most important one. That was a real achievement of Amul. I think Kurian may have hit at it intuitively or whatever it is, but that was one of his great achievements. And that was also one of the great failures, to go back to Gita's, of most of the Gandhian experiments. Because, you know, the cooperatives which they tried were, because it was idealistic cooperatives, they're cooperatives on all aspects, trying to embrace as many aspects, from going to the same school to going to, you know, blah, blah, everything, to the marketing, everything was on the, you will use the same kind of seed, you will grow the same kind of food, so on and so on. That, I think, is the same mistake as socialist collectives, collectivization. We should finish now.
Yeah.
Three more.
Okay. Professor Bhaduri, thank you very much for a very insightful talk. I was thinking, is there anything in the that one might be able to call, say, good news in the agrarian sector today? I mean, you know, given that
credit sector.
In the agrarian sector, that's what
I mean. In the agrarian sector.
Yeah. I mean, that one might be able to sort of build on.
Well, my lecture. Apart from that.
No, but more seriously, I suppose.
If I have to say at gunpoint what is the good news in the agrarian sector, I think I would probably say that the only good news in the agrarian sector is very many small local experiments which are successful in some ways. It is very unclear what their replicability is, both in terms of their political sustainability and in terms of their physical, you know, possibility. But there are very many experiments which at a limited level has been quite successful in water management, in, you know, in very dry areas, in managing water, reviving old bodies, in storing food grains, you know. There are lots of little Gandhis who are working in very many, well, Gandhi actually himself did very little, but anyway, many others have done very many interesting local things which are possible. But I think on the, and you should not expect it would not happen, because that is a matter of the politics of recognizing And I mean it very seriously, unless we all try to make clear that how important is the agrarian scene and particularly the majority who make a living out of agrarian income. Unless this is seeps into Indian politics, I don't think you can think much of a change. You might see a little fall in farmer suicide rate, some BT cotton not being allowed in future, so on and so forth. Particular, a few things might happen. But nothing major will happen.
I mean, I agree very much with what you said. The one particular issue that came to my mind, and I'm sure you probably also would agree, you know, I thought that you were a little over-optimistic about the ability, as far as technological necessity, necessity of innovations and new kind of way of handling the problem, because the problem faced by agriculture today is getting increasingly difficult. And I'm not so sure that on the basis of popularizing indigenous discoveries and so forth, it can be done. And so the question of how much to strengthen the matching between technology generation, knowledge creation, and its feedback into agriculture, something that has been destroyed, I think, you know, in the whole destruction of the extension and other systems, and its orientation, that ought to be probably given very, very strong importance, because we need to be able to generate innovations and pass it on to the farmers. Recently, it so happened that we did some interviews of people who have been coming out of agricultural universities in rural areas, and these students were actually from the villages themselves. And it was tragic that they couldn't even think of going back to the village, because what they have learned would simply not be accepted, and the mechanism to get it. So I think something has to be done regarding the receptivity mechanism which generation over there. And so that, I don't know what the form of it will be. But at the moment, there is nothing to pick it up and apply it. And the second thing is that whether the future that we are envisioning does not require education of the farmers, because I know that education creates all kinds of other tensions, but a relevant education, it seems very, very necessary. Essentially on the strength of the human capital that has been inherited, whether the challenge of the future, the challenge is what I was wondering about.
I'm not sure I can answer the question, but I can tell you one thing. You know, one of the problems of transforming a predominantly agricultural society with lots of poor, small peasants and so on into any kind of modern, well, whatever you call it, industrial society and so on. You see, there is a time lag. And what I said in the very beginning, that there is a very serious time scale incompatibility problem. If you want to maintain the democracy, your immediate problem, it may not be the problem after 10 years or 15 years, but your immediate problem is how these people can do not lose in their livelihood. I'm not sure their innovation plays such a large role. You know, I mean, number one. Number two, only yesterday I was reminded, and this is something which we have been repeatedly told, farmers learn only from farmers. Knowledge only is local knowledge. Local knowledge does not mean that what is traditional knowledge. That, you know, it is in the high-tech sense of what is nowadays called the theory of pattern formation and so on. That you only look at the person next to you and you try to imitate to some extent what he does if it is to your profitable. And if you do it on a large scale, you form patterns of a sort which you can generate on computers, blah, blah, and so on. The whole Santa Fe Institute does it. I mean, they do nothing else but this, basically. But the point is, you know, that kind of knowledge is actually at the village level, is what the, if at the village level somebody, some farmer is convinced, then, and we are reminded of this only yesterday in some talk in the evening, by a group of people who work with farmers and themselves are farmers, that a farmer only learns from a farmer. You know, and I think, you know, in that sense, this kind of innovation, I don't think It can come to corporations, it can come to, like it has come for certain kinds of, you know, technologies, certain kinds of seeds and so on and so forth, good, bad, whatever it is. But I don't think this really is the, my instinct is this probably is not the way to go in the Indian context now.
Hi. Question related to dairy and farming and sustainability of farmers and things like that. With respect to dairy cooperative movement, it's a failure. We all know. It's more of a mass product, which was need of the hour in the early 60s, 70s, 80s. 90s and all is not required.
I cannot quite understand for whatever reason. Can you stand up? I will also stand up to hear.
Thank you. Mutual respect. No, the question is, cooperative movement in dairy segment is failed. And you said there are many cooperatives of Gandhi and whatever, whatever, which could not reach to certain level. Finally, we are coming to zero. Cooperative movement is for the... say what I can answer and what I said. The first was about
cooperatives. You know, one of the things which I think probably I did not make clear, or probably you did not see what I was trying to say quite. You see, it is not that the cooperative movement succeed or fail. To think of the cooperative movement as a comprehensive unit is probably where the mistake lies. That you see, you can have cooperations in various ways. You can have cooperations in terms of, you know, marketing. You can have cooperations in terms of the way you collect seed, in the way you, you know, store and so on. Yes, the collusion, whatever you call it. And this has actually succeeded in many parts of India. You know, like, for example, storage. For example, water conservation. You have only cooperative in terms of water conservation, nothing else. Some arrangement in terms of, and this is probably the way to go. Not to try for a cooperative movement as it was traditionally understood. I mentioned Ila Bhatt because she was the first one to draw my attention to this. You know, saying that, you know, this is the way probably cooperative movements can succeed. Because as a lawyer, she broke it up into different things. The second thing which I wanted to say, you know, where you and I, is it is true. If you have property rights on land, and from the father to the son, if it gets, or to the daughter, well, daughters don't get land in North India most of the time, it gets splintered in many parts. It is true, there is no solution to it. There is only one solution which the British landed aristocracy accepted. Only the eldest son would get the land. You know, only he becomes a lord. The others only become rentiers, including Prince Charles. Prince Charles has right to land if her mother dies, but not the other children. You see, this is how the aristocracy maintained their land titles. Now, this is something which is not a great solution, but this is the only thing I can often think of. I have not thought. But it is true that the way land gets fragmented, it is almost impossible to maintain it as a viable solution. Now, regarding the last thing about importing and, you know, why agriculture land, well, we discussed it. You know, I said it, many other people said it, and so on. It is true that, you know, that jargon, in jargon it's called food security and so on and so forth. I'm not still sure I know what it means. But whatever it is, that basically if there is a tree crop land, you see, one of the problems of land acquisition has been, which Gopal Kadigudi mentioned, has been that, you know, if you take, for example, the land in the Sais area, there is an Auditor General's report, I don't know whether if you have seen, 45% of the land was not used. After it was acquired, it was simply, it has been left because of land value by the corporations. Not even real estate, it's just there, lying around. Free land, not doing anything, it's lying around. So it is not very surprising if the peasant does it also. He does it on a much smaller scale. Everybody knows that the land price is going up. If you know that the, you know, Bangalore airport is going to run here, or an expressway is going to run from this way, from, you know, from the Taj to somewhere else, you will know that land price is going to go up. And even as a peasant, you can hold on to your land. Even as a middle class person, you hold on to your land. Even as an absentee landlord. There is nothing except the awful thing which is happening in India is not that people are holding land in that way. That the reason for land acquisition, and this I want to say, I did not say in the lecture, the reason for land acquisition, one of the main reasons was the land would be given cheap to the corporations so that they invest, so that the country, at least in terms of GDP growth and so on, picks up. You know what is happening now? Not only now, for quite some time, it is more profitable to hold the land than to use it for manufacturing because it takes much longer to make the same amount of money. You know the 52 richest people on the Forbes list, I myself checked it, sitting on the computer once. 32 or 33, I've forgotten. Over, slightly over 30, I could identify as people who have direct interest in land and natural resources. They were not the, you know, well-known, you check it. The closest is Adani, who came up in the last 10 years, one of Modi's proteges. There are many others. You know, they all have come up. The Reddy brothers is another from this part. They have all come up how? Through their natural resource connection, land and others. And this is where the money is. And it's mirror image of the trade union movements. You know, I have been to these trade union movements and connected with this, what do you call this, Maruti, where, you know, somebody was killed and there is a lot of thing there. And you know what the very interesting thing there, they say that, you know, it is not the main exploitation is here. Most often, the communist parties and the traditional movements are at a complete loss because they are flogging the dead horse of trade union movement, not in any other sense, because the exploitation is not so much on the shop floor. I mean, it is there, but it is no great intensity has increased or anything like that, whatever people say. But what it is that it has shifted from the shop floor to outside the factory floor where the land is being acquired. And this is a completely different situation so far as the labor movement is concerned. So the trade unions which come up now are really the peasants. I mean, I'm talking very concretely from people I have met in Haryana and so on. Middle class peasants, exactly what we are saying, 2-3 sons. The son has virtually got no land. Okay, the father has either given it to one son or whatever it is. He has got no land. And basically, he also has a corporate job where he realizes that his land he has lost. And his anger is very often connected with the land that has been lost. And this is the biggest group of people. Surveys have been done. This is the biggest group of people who are the workers who were collected by the local panchayat leader and so on for the Maruti. And one of the things is they have lost land. Nobody know, you know, you will not hear it on the TV, but you talk to these people and you will know it. But I think.
Professor, may I? Yeah, my name is Hari, and I have a very, very short admission to make. I must be one of the odd ones here. I actually represent a large corporation which thrives in cities.
Congratulations.
And your talk has been hugely useful to me personally. And that's why I thought I must, I initially thought I'll come, sit down, listen to you, and walk away quietly. But I thought it's appropriate I make a short admission. I was actually part of the two-member group that was from the industry. It was an industry advisory group for the 12th plan on land and water. And we made that.
You mean that? Not the Monte, not the...
It's the same. Oh. There was an industry advisory group.
Okay.
It was the two members from the industry who made the recommendation which went to finally the 12th plan. That's why I thought it's appropriate that I make this admission. After listening to you, our recommendations were extremely myopic. That's the admission that I wanted to make here. And a comment, but along with it. I do take some time out and listen to, I'm not an economist, I'm just a plain hardcore engineer. I do come and sort of listen to just sort of, you know, understand things better. And what I repeatedly see is there is so much of academic understanding of the subject. And on the other side, you have practitioners. And there's so much of a gulf between the two. You know, from the industry, we keep talking about industries working with academics. Typically, it's in the context of engineering institutions and so on. But when it comes to social science and economics, I think the gulf is much higher. That's the comment that I wanted to make.
Actually talk to him afterward formally. Thanks a lot, and taking up so many questions and taking up time when you know we couldn't attract many even media to come and talk to us about the topic. Small farmers are not at all a glamorous topic for even academics, and leave alone now media. Thanks a lot for taking your time, and thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you for solidly suffering 2 hours.